One criticism that I have of the history, spiritual history, is that it seems like there's not enough follow-up from these great teachers. They rock our boat so severely. You would think that they would, follow up on this, and I don't understand why they don't. It maybe no one's asked them to. I don't know. That's only the only response I can think of. If I do a video where I said the whole world's a complete hoax, well, for one thing, within the video itself, I'll give time to let it sink in, then follow up on it, and then I'll come back the next day and follow up on what I've said. And because this stuff is very intense, you can't just leave someone hanging. When you do say something extraordinary, it seems like you need to follow up. Like a surgeon does surgery, then you go in, you have follow-up visits. How do, surgery success, but let's do follow-ups on it, right? So maybe the teachers come in and say, I successfully, deliver the truth. Well, how about follow-ups? I just don't get it. They can easily follow up on what they've done. So I just assume, have to assume that we say, yeah, that's enough, that's enough, that's enough. We don't want any follow-ups. This has to be coming from us, I would think. There's nothing restricting them from appearing. They can appear wherever they want to appear, whenever they want to appear. They don't have to go through birth. So there have been some, but very far and few between. And I just see this as very strange. Because we need follow-ups, we need reassurance. This situation is so brutal here. Absolutely brutal. So I've been trying to get some follow-ups from these teachers saying, hey, let's have some follow-ups here. I mean, they have been a little bit, but very circumspectly. Also another interesting note here. As we get into this video, and who knows what will come out of my mouth here, but I found that it is easy, way easier to be much more direct about truth if you're just doing it through a book, for instance, Jesus in A Course in Miracles. Very direct. Journey beyond words, extraordinarily direct, because he's not here in front of us. Okay, it's just a book. We're self-studying. The teachers can be way more direct and concise and clear and to the point, because we're not dealing with personal dynamic at all. Now, if the teacher was actually here in front of us, for instance, let's take Sri Anandamayi, who was very social and interacted with millions of people, it's much, much more difficult to do it that way. And I mentioned in the previous video that I prefer Jesus's style to her style, because this is really the self-study. I prefer the self-study style, because you can say stuff that you wouldn't say if you were talking with someone, sitting next to you or near you in a dialogue. There's all these social niceties, there's all these expectations, and our continuity fear precludes directness in those kind of situations. So she was extraordinarily aware of continuity fear, and clearly aware of it, and was so adept at gently moving here, moving around it this way and this way, very circumspect, very circumspect, very indirect, very circumspect, talking around it. Well, it's neither this, well, it could be this, and from another angle, it's this, and this, because the continuity fear was like so strong, and personally, in person with someone like that, where in a self-study book like Jesus has done, Jesus can just say, hey, this is it, boom, or I can say here, the whole world's a hoax. You can't say that in public to somebody that you have a social relationship with. It's quite difficult. The continuity fear is going to, bristle at this, and so, this is why I prefer this sort of, teaching where it's not so social. Maybe that's why the teachers don't come back. When you're social with people, it tends to interfere with what you can say to a large extent. So I don't know. This is very interesting to just note this. Like for instance, you cannot understand the effect that like Sri Sri Anandamayi had with those who were with her through someone writing down what she said. You know, this is what she said, or a picture. You cannot get it from that at all. You absolutely cannot. It's a very, very false picture, actually. Because all of that is the social dance and the continuity fear dance. But there's something else there that just does not transmit properly in any sort of image or word sort of situation. And the lack of bluntness and directness in speech leaves us kind of, you know, it leaves us, if that's all we have is words, it seems to be, not pretty vague, pretty doggone fuzzy and vague. And even though many great notes are hit, it's still, you know, you don't just come up to somebody and say, guess what, you know, body, humans are a complete hoax. The world is a total hoax. And on and on and on. But I can say this here, because you're in control of the video. You're in control of the distancing. You don't even know where I am. I mean, you're just watching a video on a screen in the safety of your house, the social structure of your where you're at. And you feel very comfortable and safe there. And there's nothing you need. You don't need to interact back and forth. You don't need to answer to this. You don't need to ask questions. You don't need to, you know. It takes you off the hook. It takes you off the hook, and you can hear this kind of talk. Whereas if you're going back and forth, questioning, talking, dialoguing, all sorts of reticence enters into the picture and continuity fear. Which is why I desire that more people watch the videos, because I get maybe they're thinking, you know, I need some teacher and physically present with me, but that's just going to get in the way most of in a lot of ways. In a lot of ways, it can have some benefits too, but don't think that's a cure-all. It is not. I'm able to say what I'm able to say here because there's no immediate audience present. If there was, I would be very inhibited. It would be a completely different story, and you have to account for all their continuity fear right here, right now, bouncing back at you, and you know. So it's very, very interesting, the different ways of conveying truth like this. It's just worth taking note of this. And there's nobody here expecting me to say something to them, you see, so I can do the full stop and the wow a lot better, a lot better. So socializing is incredibly difficult due to the with the truth is incredibly difficult based on the severe continuity fear, which is really the only problem that we have. If we didn't have that, we would drop this hoax immediately. We're trying to hoax God. We're trying to create a memory of what we are for God, and then flip God's script and say that the memory of what we are is really what we are, and that the immediate nowness of how God experiences us, that's a false memory. So we're trying to say that the memory of what we are is true, and the truth of what we are right now is a false memory. It's just a memory, is a memory. And it's false, therefore false. So we're literally trying to flip the script of reality in what we're doing here. And you never hear teachers say this when they're interacting with people. I've never heard it. But that's due to the fact that there's a lot of factors involved. And nevertheless, we're hearing it now. And if it wasn't for our continuity fear, we would stop this immediately. Therefore, working on the continuity fear is where it's all at. This is where it's at. It's not at anywhere else. As long as our continuity fear is in charge, and is very large and in charge, we will continue to work on this hoax. Guaranteed. No two ways about it. Therefore, one should always be practicing evaporating this continuity fear. There's nothing else to do here. There's really nothing else to do here. Otherwise, we'll continue to work on this scam. Now, the yin and the yang of this scam, of this hoax, is that we are trying to package it in a way to make God believe it's true. This memory, supposedly, well, it's not even a memory, but it's a false presentation of what we are, to say the least. We can, just for the sake of talking, we have a memory, but it's a false presentation, pretending we're something different than what we are, and that we have this history, that we go through this evolution, and there's bodies and history and all this stuff. We're trying to false memory of what we are. We're trying to sell it to God, and so packaging is all important. The content is, of course, lousy, I would say the least, but we think we can obscure that by packaging it. So we want to sell God on the packaging of this, and then flip the script on God, so God thinks that how God knows us as the now, is a false memory, and that this presentation we're giving God is actually the truth of what we are. Okay, you got that? Flipping the whole script on God is what we're trying to do. So packaging is the key, what we think is the key to success. And now, so we get into the yin and the yang. I don't know which is the male, female, yin or yang, I don't know, whatever. But the what has more importance in this hoax is packaging. And the female aspect is the packaging aspect of it. The male aspect is to go out there and get the raw materials, okay, and provide the material for the packaging. In other words, go down there in the boondocks out in the mountains, find the diamonds, dig into the earth, tunnel underneath the earth, find the diamonds, bring them out, cut them, make them beautiful, and then give a diamond necklace to the feminine, so she can say, look how beautiful I am, look at the packaging, look how happy I am, look how radiant I am, look how reflecting the light, look, this, God, this is what we are, this is how it works here. We just have to look at it and see how it works. So the male aspect is more the worker aspect, and the female aspect is more the packaging aspect. It's the marketing aspect of it. So we know I was looking at this, for example, I was looking at this old Coca-Cola dispensing machine that's no longer in use. It was sitting out in a parking lot today. I saw it. And I was just sitting there. I was waiting for someone. I was just looking at it. And then it dawned on me. He says, you know what? This is genius. I mean, I remember the days when they came out, these refrigerated, beautiful aluminum refrigerated things with bright, you know, Coca-Cola lit up there. And it was just, and I realized that I would buy soft drinks just because the experience was so cool, the way they were presenting it, the way they were packaging it, you know, that I could just a standalone box that was aluminum everywhere, beautiful aluminum, the way they did everything, and then the plastic way, the colorful lights and the design of the Coke bottles and everything lit up and cold. And I realized what an extraordinary job they did marketing this and packaging it. What an extraordinary job. And it still looked great. After all these years, I still felt like, you know, I feel like I want to put some money. You put money in this thing and then hit this thing and then this cold, ice cold can drops out. And of course, the content is terrible. I mean, Coke's terrible for you. Soft drinks are terrible for you. But I was so, and you know, so taken by the way they packaged it that I was willing to take this lousy content. It's called marketing. It's called packaging. And we don't quite realize how powerful it is for us. For us, it's powerful. We think that we can fool God the same way that we're saying, hey, God, you know, we're not really now. We're not now. and your belief that we're now is wrong. That's a false memory. And this is what we really are, is not now. We're not really eternal life. We're really just life that dies. And eternal life is a false memory, God. It's a dream that you're having. This is what we really are. And so we're trying to package this, market it to God. And so the marketing aspect is the most important aspect. You can take the content is lousy, you know, but it's the marketing. I mean, it's like the getting those diamonds and digging them out of the dirt and they don't look anything that special or anything like that. Then cutting them, polishing them, and then setting them in, you know, in gold and various settings, and then stringing them together, and ultimately the final product is this dazzling, beautiful necklace. And then the feminine puts on the necklace, you know, and with all the other marketing packaging aspects and says, you know, it's like, look, God, this is the self that you really love. This is what you really created. You didn't really create eternal life. That's nothing. Look how beautiful I am. Look how attractive I am. Look how the packaging, you know, of death is so wonderful. And you know, and I saw this today. I've always seen this, but nobody wants to express it. Is this is what's really going on. We are engaged, the yin and the yang, together is engaged in trying to perpetrate this massive hoax upon God. This is all we're doing. We don't love one another, male and female. There's no love there. Let's stop kidding ourselves. We are simply both engaged together in trying to perpetrate this hoax upon God. And, you know, the packaging people and marketing people say, hey, you know, don't mess with, we're great, we're experts at what we do. Don't mess with us. You do, you know, you do your job, you get the raw materials, you get us the stuff, that then we'll, you know, we'll do the marketing and packaging. And, you know, this is how it is. And so, you know, the men dutifully go out and, you know, dig, tunnel, get the oil, get the minerals, get the, grow the cotton, grow the textiles, do the chemical work, do everything, everything as far as, you know, extracting all these raw materials and ingeniously getting them, you know, distributing them, machines, robots, everything. And then, you know, there's the woman marketing and presenting the beautiful clothing. You know, look at me, I'm in this beautiful car, I'm dressed so beautiful, my hair is tinted so beautiful, I'm so awesome, God, this existence that ends in sickness and death is so awesome, you know, this must be what you created. So, you know, this is actually what's happening. And everybody kind of knows it, but nobody's willing to say anything because of the continuity fear. I always wondered what are women dressing up for and make themselves And because it's not for men, really. It isn't. It isn't. And it's not really for women. It's a strange thing. What it is for God, actually. They're doing it to try and convince God. It's a marketing campaign. This is something that maybe you've never heard before. I've never said it before. But it's the truth. It is the truth. And why are men giving women all the stuff, working so hard, working themselves to death, and giving all the stuff to women? Why? So they can market it. So this hoax, we can try to hoax God. That's why they're doing that. Now, for me, I don't feel a need to do this, you know. I don't feel like I should be working myself to death trying to provide women with, you know, all this beautiful, the tools of looking, you know, stunning, so they can try to market it to God. I don't have any feel like I need to do this at all. And in fact, I greatly resent it because it's I see through what's going on. But of course, what we really are is spirit. But we have imagined ourselves, you know, how can we hoax God? How can we perpetrate a hoax upon God so that we can prove that we're greater than God? Change God's will. God says, oh my gosh, I thought I created you as the eternal now and perfect freedom, but I realized that was just a fantasy I was having, just a fantasy of a past, a memory that is in the past. And now I see that these beautiful humans in this wonderful world wearing these beautiful clothes and looking so glamorous, that's what I really created. And they're flesh and they're born to die and, you know, but oh yeah, that's what I really created. You know? The other's just a fantasy of an ancient memory. This is what we're trying to get God to agree to. Which, of course, has no possibility of ever happening whatsoever. It's just absolute futility. What's with all the jewelry, you know? I mean, what's up with, I, you know. The women say, I've got to have jewelry. Man says, what are you talking about? You know, I mean, you don't need to be wearing jewelry for me. I mean, I don't even look at it. I don't even pay attention to it. And most men, after a while, don't even pay attention to how their wife or, you know, girlfriend or looks like. I mean, it just says, like, you know, why are you spending all this time and money trying to, you know, look so glamorous and everything? I mean, you're not doing it for me. What are they doing it for? They're working on this packaging and marketing, plain and simple. And they get very frightened if they don't have all this stuff, and very angry. And men also don't understand why they get so angry. I want more. You know, I suddenly got a, you got a whole, you know, you got so much jewelry, you got so many clothes, a whole closet, you got hundreds of shoes. No, I need more. And men say, what is this? I don't, you know, isn't this enough? No, I haven't quite sold God yet. You know, no one says it. But what really they're saying is, God isn't sold yet. I got to do a better job. And the man understands, yeah, I guess so. I gotta somehow find a way to help you out there, because if we don't market it to God, we'll never succeed. The marketing is the only hope we have, because really it's ridiculous what we're doing, but we think if we just market it the right way, maybe we can get God to believe it. So as I've always said, women do have the upper hand. Their role is more important in this hoax, is marketing it to God, packaging it, is the only hope we have. It's the only hope we have. This is why Agenda 21, the United Nations, is leaning so heavily on women. They say this is the only hope we have. This is the only way we're ever going to succeed. And, you know, it's basically a feminist institution, the United Nations. Let's just tell it like it is. This is the truth. This is the truth. It's a feminist institution, the United Nations, as is Agenda 21. And what it is designed to make sure that men realize what their place is. Put men in their place, which is to continue to be good little robots, providing everything that women need, the accoutrement, for this present song and dance, this presentation and packaging that we feel is the only hope we have to escape this terrible continuity fear. This is how I see the world and how it's, and this is just the honest way. I've always seen it this way, but nobody talks this way. So you feel you can't even say this, that you got some terrible something wrong with you. I mean, I see this, but I can't say it. You know, what's wrong? What's wrong? Something's wrong. Because of continuity fear, nobody wants to say anything about it. It's too frightening for everybody. Because if we start looking at it, we might say, well, this is nuts. And they'll say, oh my gosh, I'm going to stop because there's no hope then. I'm not going to ever sell God of this. And then, well, that means I'm not going to, I don't want to keep working on this then. This is ridiculous. I'm tired of this. Okay, I'm going to set it down. Stop it. Oh, wait a minute. That means, you know, I'm right back accepting that I'm all of me is right now. And we've been imagining that none of us is right now, that we're not right now at all. And so to suddenly realize that all of everything is right now. It's just the isness is just, that's all that is right now. And this is a continuity fear that we're terrified of it. So virtually nobody blows the whistle. I mean, nobody has blown the whistle like I'm blowing the whistle in these videos, actually, that I've ever heard. And because I'm, you know, isolated and distance and not in talking to people one-on-one or whatever, I'm able to do this. I'm able to do this, and people are able to listen to it because they don't feel much any pressure. Like, oh, you know, do I have to agree with it or disagree? Say, oh, I need say, nay, I neither agree nor do I disagree, or say, yeah, say, I neither agree with this nor do I disagree. Just practice this neither nor. That's all you have to do. I'm not saying anyone has to agree with me, but I am saying just say, I neither agree nor do I disagree. Do this intentional definitional neutrality. When you hear the truth, go into this intentional neutrality about it, because then whatever is what you're going to be feeling. It's like you don't, let's say you're pretending you don't know what the temperature is. Well, you think it's something different. Well, if you just say, well, it's neither hot nor is it cold. It's neither hot nor is it cold. So in other words, you're just saying, I don't know what the temperature is. I just am, I have no idea. I do not know. I do not know. Well, if you take that position and you're not advocating a particular temperature, right? Then you're going to end up feeling what the temperature actually is, the isness of the temperature. You'll end up feeling it. You'll end up feeling it. And this is all that is required of us, is simply, we don't need to do anything. We just need to practice this intentional definitional neutrality, but we're not advocating any particular position at all. Therefore, our mind is capable of experiencing what is. The temperature will feel what is if we don't. But if we're insisting on saying, I know the temperature is really hot, I'm absolutely certain of the temperature is really hot, oh, I'm feeling so hot, or conversely, if we say, oh, I know the temperature is really cold, I'm really freezing, I'm cold, then we'll feel that, right? We'll imagine we're feeling that. But if we just say, the temperature is neither hot nor is it not hot, the temperature is neither cold nor is it not cold. In other words, I don't know, neutral. Then the isness of what the temperature is, we will feel it. We will feel it. Now, this new Agenda 21 and the situation that's going on in the world is a reinvestment in the whole hoax. Okay, a super reinvestment in the hoax. How did this happen? We thought we were getting awakening from it, didn't we? What happened was high technology came into the picture, digital technology. And what this did would was give a quantum leap to our capacity to package and market the packaging aspect. I mean, it's extraordinary just looking at the marketing in the packaging industry right now. It's just extraordinary. With all the robotic mechanisms, computerized mechanisms, the lasers, just whatever they've done, is they've, you know, the design and the packaging and everything has taken a quantum leap. And so what we have is, like, we say, hey, wait a minute, you know, we were getting to the point where we thought, hey, this hoax isn't working, and we're all feeling like the women were saying, like, look, I've put on every dress, like every kind of costume I possibly can, and it hasn't worked. The men are saying, look, I've dug for every treasure I can possibly dig for. It hasn't worked. So let's take a look at this. And along came artificial intelligence. Okay. and a whole new, you know, horizon, a landscape, a whole new landscape of marketing and packaging became possible. And so the women said, hey, wait a minute, you know, maybe we can do this. At least let's try. And you know, look at all the different ways we can, you know, glamorize ourselves now and package ourselves and, you know, make the body look so interesting. And look at all the, you know, how I can surround myself with all these beautiful, I mean, my God, I mean, the ladies now, the packagers, the feminine, they're spending, dropping like, you know, $50,000 on the tile in their bathroom now. Okay, this is true. I'm telling you, they make their bathroom into the Taj Mahal. Really? It's like, so they go to the shower and say, hey God, look how beautiful, look, you know, look where I am. I'm it's so beautiful. Oh my gosh, the body is so awesome. You know, look at this Taj Mahal. I mean, it's better than the Taj Mahal, some of these bathrooms. They're dressing up their homes to an extraordinary extent. I mean, just go into a tile shop, for instance, and it'll just blow your mind. You know, a really high-end tile shop. Just go into the slab area of tile shops right now, with all the huge stone slabs they have. Hundreds and hundreds and hundreds from all over the world. And just tour around in there and it'll just blow your mind. This is packaging. This is marketing, you see. I go into a store and there's this countertop and it's like, this is like the stone is just like mind-blowing. And I said, what was the stone? They said, yeah, well, that's got green Amazon, came out of the Amazon somewhere, green Amazon, blah, 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 blah. You know, and of course, it's cut beautifully and it's polished beautifully. And you just like, the whole thing, like, it's just like an extraordinary gemstone. It's just like, it's amazingly beautiful. Well, there's that thousands and thousands and thousands of different patterns from every kind of stone formation in the world is now present. You just go drive right down, put it in your home, the whole bathroom, the shower. They'll put these massive slabs, you know, as in their shower, in their bathrooms, especially countertops, in their kitchen. So, the tiles available is just, you know, is extraordinary what they're doing, how they're cutting everything, and gluing it, and the patterns, the computer patterns, the kind of patterns they're giving. So, I mean, everybody's like a princess that lives in the Taj Mahal now can be. And so the women seeing this massive upgrade in packaging, the feminine, said, hey, you know, maybe we're not such failures at hoaxing God. Maybe we can do it. And then they said, hey, guys, we're not quitting yet. Whereas the guy said, you know, like, hey, you know, whatever, knock yourself out, but we're really tired of this. And but the women said, no, you can't quit. You can't quit. You got to do your part too. So go out there and cut those stones, you know, load them on a truck, deliver them to the tile place, unload them, put them in the showroom, go put them in our homes, you know, and do all this stuff. And so we can, you know, pretend that we're these awesome princesses and queens. Every woman's a queen now, you know. But this, you know, it used to be we were so blatant in advertising back in the 20th century. If you look at that, you see how obvious it is now. They'd say every woman can now be a queen. Be the queen of your house. Look at this refrigerator, you know. Look at this. I mean, and back then, I mean, like refrigerators, for instance. I talk about the Coke machines being nice, but the refrigerators. I mean, my God. The way that they're able to produce these beautiful refrigerators and with the ice makers, I remember that the ice makers, I mean, you just felt like, you know, your domestic goddess, you know, absolute domestic goddess. We started getting these beautiful aluminum appliances with all, you know, the aluminum just blew everyone's mind. Okay, this is really what got things going was aluminum. Coming into the house, you know, in appliances and in cars and everything. It's still beautiful. I mean, aluminum still rocks my boat, you know. I'm just seeing it. I just realized, wow. I'm seeing some old cars, some trucks that where a lot of aluminum was used. Chrome is another thing, chrome, aluminum. And it still looks great. It still looks great. Because aluminum, you know, like, doesn't rust. It, like, lasts forever. And it's extraordinary metal, you know. And we were just knocked out by aluminum. And eventually, the thrill wore off. But then that's when digital technology came in and began to throw all these patterns and variety, massive variety. You go in there and you got so many choices now. Just look how many choices in paint you have now. You know, you get this color wheel of paint and you can just go in and get anything you want. They'll just mix it right there for you and you just, you know. So the temptation to keep working on packaging this hoax and marketing and packaging it to God is become very, very strong. The strongest it's ever been in history. Nothing comes close. I mean, in the past, you have, you know, Shah Jahan and his princess or queen and, you know, the Taj Mahal and using all these workers from all over India and getting all these stones and building this. Okay, that's really beautiful. Okay, stunning. Still is. But that was just like, you know, just this great, powerful king could do that. But everybody else, no, they live in these little huts. Wasn't so glamorous. Nowadays, a great many numbers of women, for instance, can have these very, 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 very queen-like homes, okay, like Taj Mahals of their own. It's spread all over the world if you have the means, and many have the means now. They can have all this, like, look at the iPhone, look at the, you know, smartphone, look at these cool smartphones, and they're all different, you know, colors, and they're making them, you know, more and more and more attractive and cool looking, and, you know, these are accessories, you know, all these cool gadget accessories. Look how incredibly sleek and elegant and in shape and how beautiful I am and how I accessorize, and look at my home, so, just suppressing a sneeze. And look at this, you know, look at this Tesla I'm driving. I mean, it's just like, look at these queens. You know, they go to the blow dry bar. They're driving their Teslas. And then the newest fashion, you know, skin tight fashion. And they're in such great shape. And, you know, they're just saying, look how awesome I am. I mean, like, who are they trying to impress? God. Trying to impress God. And, of course, the guys are hoping. I hope they succeed because we're so tired of all this, you know. We just want happiness somehow, you know. As if, how does scamming God, hoaxing God bring us happiness? Well, we haven't figured that out yet. We just think magically it will happen. But, of course, nothing's going to happen. We cannot hoax God. God knows what we are. God created us and is an extension of God. There's no way for God to see us any differently than how God created us, actually. And so, you know, now we have, you know, different metals that have come out. Titanium is used a lot, and just the plastics. Everything is upgraded. All materiality has been upgraded to an extreme extent, and the availability is worldwide to women everywhere in the world now. And the United Nations, their goal is really to elevate women all over the world so they can all be queens. This is what their goal really is. And they just expect men, you know, you just got to keep doing your thing, you know, and make it possible for every woman to be a queen. But, you know, men will say, well, I don't need that, you know. Well, that's not the point of this hoax, is it? It's, we're trying to hoax God. It's not about men. It's about trying to hoax God. And so the UN just says, that it doesn't matter, guys. You're just going to do what we, you know, tell you to do. This is the agenda. And that's all there is to it. We got to make this hoax work. But, you know, if you're a guy, you're saying, well, you know, what if it doesn't work? It's kind of, you know, it's a very lowly position. I mean, guys are not really into all this frou-frou, she-she, you know, castle, queen's castle thing, you know, like, yeah, I know, they just kind of shrug their shoulders and say, you know, why do we need to spend $50,000 on the tile in the bathroom, you know, I mean, it's just like, just put some linoleum in for a couple $100, I'm good to go, you know, I don't need all these fancy, you know, appliances and hardware on sinks and everything gilded and gold and beautiful, just give me a faucet, I mean, you know, what the heck? No, we really don't care that much, really. No, but the women, oh, man. I mean, they're ferocious about it. But what is it? Why? For what? They're trying to say, God, this is what we are. This is what you created. Look how beautiful your creation is. Look at this. Look at this bathroom. Look at this tile. Look at this house. Look at what I've done. Look how beautiful my home is. God, this is the home you created. This is what you created. And God, you know, and they say to the man, get out of here. I don't want him seeing you. You're gonna blow the marketing thing. You know, just get lost for now. Let me do my marketing thing on God. So it's kind of like, okay, you did your thing, now just get lost. You know, you're going to blow the commercial. So they're all making commercials, basically. They're involved in making these spiritual commercials, trying to sell God on this hoax. But of course, men are also, you know, it's the spirit that wants this. So men agree. They say, okay, I'll get out of the way here. Okay, I hope you sell it. You know, I hope you sell it. If you don't, I'll change the tile. Maybe the tile wasn't right. Let's change it. The landscaping wasn't quite right. So they get all these, you know, storybook princess storybook homes and lives. Driving around the car, you know, convertibles, look at me, it looks so awesome. But what are they doing this for? I mean, it's like, you know, there's this feeling like, what's going on here? I don't quite get it. Well, now we do get it. That's actually what's going on. It's for God. the commercials we make for God. So if you're going to make a commercial to sell a product, what are you going to do? You're going to get the most beautiful model you can, probably, right? Try to get some real stunning model and just saying, you know, look at this product, you know. This product is what made me so stunningly beautiful, right? Or I love those who use this product. I want to hang out with them. You know, I like to be around them. So you think, oh, gee, you know, maybe if I get this product, this beautiful, stunning model will hang out with me. Or, you know, they just associate it in various ways, market in various ways. So they're trying to sell God. Look at your handiwork. Look how great your handiwork is. Look how awesome I am. Look how flawless I am. Look at my skin. It's perfect. Well, of course, the whole thing is all God makeup, you know, make it all look so smooth and shiny. And look at how attractive I am. Look at how, you know, and and of course, all the photographers and fashion photographers and all this whole industry of constantly taking pictures and lighting and changing how they look and, you know, their expression, you know, all these models, they all these expressions, and look how attractive, look how wonderful I am. And of course, they test out their track commercial. See how they do dry runs of the commercial. They have, like, you know, focus groups. Who are they in the focus groups? Men, of course. They say, hey guys, I'd like to try out my commercial on God. So I want to first try it out on you. So I want to know what your reaction is. So this is really the relationship that the male and females have. Is the females are testing out their attractiveness to see trial run on men. But then they'll just kind of say, okay, it worked on you good. Okay, now I'm gonna try on God. And that's why men find, why are women, we can't, you know, figure them out. Like, one moment they're so into us, you know, the next moment, no, it's like they're into something else, we don't even know what it is. Well, it's because now they're turning to God and saying, okay, God, these men here think I'm really something else, you know, and look at your handiwork, God. Isn't this awesome? They kind of want the men to just play dumb in terms of the ultimate packaging and marketing of it. Just, you know, get us the stuff, buy us the dresses, you know, get us the homes, make the homes, do all the stuff, and then let us sell God on it, okay? Just don't get in our way. And of course, when we kind of be clumsy, we kind of roll our eyes, say, oh my God, he doesn't get it, you know, he doesn't understand. He thinks I'm into him. What an idiot, you know. I was just testing out, you know, the perfume on you, just to see, you know, if it was as good as I thought it was. And you know, now I'm back to my true business, which is, hey God, look how wonderful I smell. Look how wonderful I smell. And so... This is what's going on. And the only way you get to this really is to work on your continuity fear. I couldn't have ever gotten to this if I didn't work on my continuity fear. It's astonishing I even got to this. You know, I don't know anyone's gotten to this. It has taken a lifetime of work to get to this. Absolute lifetime of constant work to get to this. You know, but what else are you going to do here, actually? You know, you got to get to this eventually. And, but they say, hey, shit, you're blowing my cover. God's not supposed to know any of this. Of course God knows all this already. God knows that we're exactly as God created us, and that we're trying to flip the script and convince him that this is what he created, this wonderful, wonderful, beautiful bodies, these wonderful bodies. And if men try to say, wait a minute, maybe I can try to sell God, and the women will say, are you kidding me? What an idiot. Get out of here. He says, you know, they say, okay, look, okay, do you find me attractive? The man will say, oh, yeah. Well, do you think I find you attractive? The man says, oh, I'm not sure. Well, guess what? Not really, no. So by extension, they say, look, God's not going to find you attractive either. So, you know, you're not going to succeed at all, but God's going to find me attractive, and then I'll be able to sell God on the belief that God created bodies, you know? And the man says, oh, yeah, okay, I get it. Yeah. I mean, within the logic of the hoax, it has a logic, right? It's, okay, well, this, it has a plausibility. Okay, you say, sure, okay, right. That's why, like, when men try to be fashion models, everyone just kind of says, oh, please, come on. You know, really, really, you know, they look like, you know, stiff boards, you know, they're just like, no, that's not going to work. And then you throw those model, supermodels out, you know, and they're like, look, God, this is what you really like, and, you know, and then you say, oh, yeah, that's got a lot more likelihood, you know, we think of selling God on this hoax than the male models. This is what, you know, it's 100-to-1 kind of thing. So this is why this is what makes the world go round. The hoax go round. This is what makes the hoax go round. And it's the same old, same old. And so all that's happening in the world with the United Nations Agenda 21 is, you know, their whole thing is empowering women, so that they all can be queens. You know, and collectively they think they'll be able to sell God on heaven. We just have all the women, you know, just men just work, give all their money to women, let them decide what makes them beautiful and attractive, how they feel beautiful and attractive and empowered, and then let them market and just get out of the way, and hopefully this will work. And this is where the world is going. Absolutely is where it's going. I mean, the men are like just basically listen, you know, listening to the queens and the princesses as if they were the oracles of truth themselves, you know, and they don't listen to the Holy Spirit at all, because they just say, yes, dear, yes, dear, yes, dear. What can I do to make you more be attractive to God? Oh, yes, dear, okay. And this is it. This is our culture. This is the world culture right now. And if you understand that this is completely futile, then the world culture is not attractive in any way, shape, or form, actually. It's just this ridiculous hoax. There's no attractiveness to it. The more you realize what's going on, the less attractive world culture becomes. And the idea of putting lipstick on of the United Nations is just making it worse. I mean, they're just going to, you know, this is what's really going on. I mean, what do you, you know, okay, California, equal pay for women. Now, you know, Jerry Brown signed this. It's a very, very strong bill. Yeah, okay, so the idea is get the money in women's hands. They know, you know, let them go shopping. Let them do the shopping. Because before, it didn't work. You know, the men might have had some say, you know. Now it's just, men, shut up. Get out of the way. It didn't work. You know, you're not the star of the show. It's the model, it's the supermodel, it's the queen who's the star of the show. give her all the money. I mean, the man, equal pay. Well, the man goes out and works as hard as he can and gives all his money to the woman, already. So now a man goes out and works as hard as he can, gives all his money to the woman. The woman goes out and gets equal pay and keeps all the money for herself. So she can just go out and shop. And the man's just a slave. This is the truth of the situation. This is the absolute truth of the situation. In general terms, which is, of course, if we didn't speak in general terms, we wouldn't be able to give the outlines at all. This is an outline of the overall situation we're in. This is the momentum. This is the trend. This is what's going on. So a man would like to keep some of the stuff for himself. Say, wait a minute, I don't think you can sell God on this hoax, and I'd like to have some money for myself, actually, so I can do something I want to do instead of just playing the slave to your, princess queen complex. But no. That's become illegal now, basically. That's sexist. You got to, it's not right. It's not fair. Let the star of the show, be liberated so they can really sell God. You've stood in their way. That's why it hasn't worked. No, it's not a hoax. It's just you've stood in the way of the star. You haven't given them, you haven't shown the light, on them enough. And let them emerge fully and let them, do their commercials fully to God. And then that will work. So what they're really doing is they're doubling down on the hoax. The United Nations is doubling down on this hoax. Extraordinarily sexist organization, the United Nations. They're obsessed with empowering and promoting women to be these supermodel queen princesses, and so they can focus on that and succeed at the hoax, hoaxing God. Now, in the past, religion says, "Hey, you can't hoax God." I mean, they try to get this through and saying, hey ladies, give it up, be modest, be humble, be chaste, in other words, don't go down this road of trying to sell God on this hoax. This is a waste of your time, it's a waste of everybody's time. It's the wrong road to take. So in religions, they are very strict about this issue. And they say, ladies, dress very modestly. Don't be glamorous. Don't be glamorous. Cover up. Stop trying to get into this belief that you have to become, you have to attract God and make, make God lose God, lose God's mind in some sort of intoxicated attraction to you so that God will believe in this hoax. This will never work. Will never work. So it's folly. It's idiocy to go down this path. So cover up. Be modest, cover your hair, cover your face, don't wear makeup, jewelry, all this stuff. Break this terrible bad habit, because it's a horrible habit that women have, and men, stop treating women as if they were these glamorous goddesses, stop giving them all this jewelry, keep working, stop trying to tell them that they can succeed, they can say, you need to be this, the sex object or something, they need this, men need to back off of that too, though. So both male and females need to back off of this hoax. Okay, all right, someone just emerged there. Okay, it's all good. It's unusual. So we both need to back off of those. So all I'm doing is I'm backing off of this hoax. That's all I'm doing. I'm saying, look, it doesn't work. Guys and gals, let's all back off of this. This is nonsense. So each one of us has to do our part in backing off of it. We need to, the men have to stop pretending like women are so, awesome and glamorous and the answer to our problems, and, stop, working like crazy to empower all their glamour, And stop treating them as if they're these goddesses and queens, this thing. And stop encouraging it. Stop encouraging it. And stop believing in it. And stop pretending, thinking, oh yeah, it's going to work, you know. And the women need to, you know, need to back off the glamour and all the posing and all the materiality and believing that they can sell God on this, that there's some kind of this awesome, you know, goddesses that can say, hey, God, look at this goddess you created, you know. Back off that. So collectively, we all need to back off of this. This is not what the United Nations is presenting at all. Just the opposite. Agenda 21 for the 21st century. In no way, shape, or form are they addressing this in any way. They're going the opposite direction. So it's a disaster. No place in the world you ever hear a man talking like this. It just shows you how drastically we're going in the wrong direction. It used to be you did hear plenty of men talking in similar lines, not as blunt, not as direct and clear as this, but certainly there was plenty of admonishments, and there are plenty of women who understood this and did their part and backed off. You know, I'd say equal share, men and women, they backed away from this. So this is what religion, the Puritan ethics, so use Christianity as an example, the Puritan ethic, very important. Back off of it. And yeah, the women policed other women. If they saw one of them trying to go down that road of glamour, they said, no, that doesn't work. We're not going to do that anymore. And if the men saw some man trying to, you know, encourage the flirtatiousness of women and giving, you know, mistress, giving them clothes, buying them finery and trying to, you know, this stuff, they said, hey, no, we don't treat our women that way. We don't try to glamorize them that way. You know, so the society policed itself. Society policed itself. This is appropriate. This is going in the right direction as far as liberation from this hoax, which we're the ones that have to set down the hoax. God didn't make the hoax. We're imagining. We're the ones trying to perpetrate this hoax on God. So we're the ones that have to set it down. So we got to back away from it and evaporate the continuity fear. But the world has gone so bad. You don't hear, you don't hear men speaking like this anywhere anymore. And you don't see women speaking up either anymore. They try. They've still, you know, they made a great effort, but they've just gotten crushed by other women. Just telling them that they're just under the control of men or something, you know, that they're weak women. You know, which is a total lie. It's just the opposite. There's a lot of women that said, "Hey, this path we're going in modern world is not the right path. It doesn't work. We're tired of trying to sell God on this." But you know, the marketing machine of this world, the glamour machine, it's just, you know, crushing that. It's been crushing it. And they've lost their voice. They've been defeated in so many battles. You know, they're seen as just weak, submissive women. You know, undermining the potentiality of women, and you know, they've just been, the feminists have gone after them with torches and pitchforks in the most hideous way, and so most of them have just been, you know, kind of, you know, crushed. There's really, you know, very little will left on this planet to back away from this disastrous path the world is on. Doubling down on the hoax. And it's so difficult because men and women just can't talk with one another because they don't understand what the problem is. And they keep blaming each other instead of realizing they're both in on this hoax, and both of them need to back away together collectively, you know, and to remind one another and thank one another, you know, for taking the appropriate attitudes toward one another. Oh, thanks for reminding me that I need to dress more appropriately and more modest like that, and don't try to encourage men to, you know, and don't test my glamour out on my attractiveness out on men. To see, okay, oh, it's working for him. Maybe it'll work for God. You know, keep thinking, you know, don't go out there and say, look at me, look at me, look at me. And, you know, and then, so thanks for reminding me that. And then the man, you know, and when the man says, "Why, well, hey, you know, why don't you, you know, let's go out and maybe you can dress up." And she says, hey, no, I don't want to do that." The man says, "Oh, thanks for reminding me, you know, that, you know, we're backing away for this whole thing." Or, you know, where the man starts thinking, "Oh, you're so wonderful." She says, "Wait a minute, what are you talking about? I'm not, you know, I'm not, I don't want you to evaluate me that way, you know, because I'm not trying to get God to evaluate me that way either," right? So we're backing away from that and working on our continuity fear. And so together it's possible to do that. And it has been done in history. In fact, this has been the only advances we've ever made in history, is when both men and women back away from this hoax, and they begin to, continuity fear begins to evaporate, and they be, you know, be, the culture becomes more spiritualized because of that. And some realization begins to happen. That's the only progress we've ever made in this world. And this is what's being completely made extinct on this planet. And of course, it goes beyond that, because you ultimately realize that also this idea of, you know, oh, you know, the chic of, like, the nun, look how chaste, look how pure, look I am, look God, look what you made, this pure, chaste, wonderful woman. That's like the same thing. It's still trying to sell God that God made bodies, right? So it's a what we're really looking for is a genuine effort towards spiritual practice. Neither nor practice, for instance. I neither see a light, nor do I not see the light. I neither see the darkness, nor do I not see the darkness. I neither see light and dark, nor do I not see light and dark. I neither accept light and darkness, nor do I not accept light and darkness. You can, you know, practice even to this extent. So this backing away is not an end in itself. This backing away then needs to be the what it frees up is your capacity to start practicing spiritual practices. Affirmations and neither nor practice, for instance. Prayers, then affirmations and neither nor. Definitional zeroing out. Definitional neutrality. You can call it definitional neutrality. Then you have to do that. You can't just say, "Hey, look, like I said, hey, look, God, look how, you know, wonderful, wonderfully modest I am. This must be your creation." You know, that's not it either, okay? That's a trap, and we've gotten caught in that trap, which is why we keep ping-ponging back and forth. Say, "Oh, gee, that great, you know, modesty didn't work, so let me try to sell immodesty to God." You know, no, we're not bodies. God didn't create bodies. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So we have to keep working on definitional neutrality so we can experience what is. Who we really are. Because that's what we are. God's not going to change what we are. We got no choice then but to experience what we are. So it's how to back away from this hoax effectively. How to evaporate the continuity effectively is how we back away from this hoax. So in the past we worked on it, but we are still trying to sell God on bodies. You know, now we have good bodies, God. Modest. Chased modest bodies. That didn't work, and now we're going to God. Look at the immodest bodies. We have very immodest bodies. We have, you know, we have these glamour queens, you know, now, which are, you know, this is just they're trying to think maybe this will work, you know. And they look at the history of women. They're always trying some different style, trying to sell God. Well, this didn't work. Let me try this. And you just go back to the history of it. It's extraordinary. It's absolutely extraordinary. Men pretty much look the same, you know, throughout history. Just drones, you know. But the women, my God, you know, you go back, like, costuming and hairstyles and jewelry and everything. There's some encyclopedias and stuff that go back throughout history and showing that it's just like, it's extraordinary, absolutely extraordinary. The different styles that they've cooked up, you know. The Victorian style, like the you know, the corsets and the hoops, you know, the hoop skirts and the corsets and the big giant hats and, you know, just everything. I mean, just like exotic creatures or something. And they'll keep trying, they'll keep trying, they'll keep trying, they'll keep trying. This is the thing. If you know, and since nothing works, what do? They keep trying something different. And the men, you know, are just, you know, still the drones, you know, put a, you know, black and white penguin suit on the man, tuxedo, and, you know, call him dashing. So, you know, how in the world can this world be turned around? I don't know. Genuinely turning around, instead of just shifting styles of marketing styles, I mean, to genuinely back away from it, you have to do spiritual practice, you know, because if you don't, it's just another marketing style. You know, this modesty becomes just another marketing style. So really, wherever you are, whether you're modest or immodest, you should start doing spiritual practice. It's the only way to back away from it really effectively. Because we've seen the shifting throughout history, and you think women have changed, but they really haven't changed. They're still frantically marketing. So where's the change been? There hasn't been any change. In my opinion, they're the same as they've always been. Nothing has happened. Nothing has changed. They're just frantically marketing still. So the way to back away isn't necessarily to, you know, it is certainly good to go towards modesty. In all ways, severe modesty, you might say. But at the same time, right spiritual practice has to be done. But even if you don't go to severe modesty, you can back away from it by doing right spiritual practice. And then from doing that, you will automatically go into much more severe modesty, absolutely. You'll stop marketing it. You say, hey, you know, forget it. And I'm not going to even think about the body. I'm not even thinking myself as a body. It's extraordinary. Women are so extraordinary, I've noticed. The Holy Spirit had me just spend time just being completely neutral and observing, and I noticed all of the subtle adjustments that women make. It's absolutely extraordinary. I said, why are they doing this? It's so weird. I noticed these little things, you know, that most men are completely oblivious to, because we're told, don't bother, don't even pay attention. If you really pay attention to women, then you see this little marketing dance that they're doing is they're constantly making little adjustments in their clothing, their skin, how much skin is being revealed and not being revealed. As they move, they bend over, they'll adjust this, they'll adjust this, or this. They're constantly marketing themselves. To what? To God, constantly. They're always aware. They're always aware of their body image and how it looks. It's amazing, absolutely extraordinary. And always this way. Almost all women are. If any little thing in their clothing, whatever, is out of place, they're aware of it. Super conscious of packaging. Super, super conscious of it. And very, very deft at adjusting it. And it happens so quickly and smoothly that if you're not really, really aware, you're not even really going to pay it, recognize it at all. Astonishing. This is their genius. They're geniuses at packaging. Why? You know, to God, packaging this hoax. Hey God, you made this is what you made. And of course they have this constant insecurity, because they blame it all on men, say, you're not making me beautiful enough. But it's ridiculous. It's not men's fault. It's that this hoax doesn't work. So this is being misinterpreted. Men are being blamed now in this world for the failure of this hoax, as if they're not doing enough. It's their fault. No. The fault is that we can't hoax God. It's impossible. So how is that men's fault that they can't make the impossible possible? See, this is what men have been told. Hey, it's your fault that the impossible isn't possible. And I say, no, it's nobody's fault at all. It's just reality. It's not a fault of anyone. We're not at fault at all that women haven't been able to sell God on this hoax. It's because God cannot be sold on this hoax, no matter what we do. So how can we be at fault if no matter what we do, it's never going to work? I don't have guilt. I don't feel blame or guilt, because I know it's impossible. But the men are just being savage. You know, men, it's all your fault, whatever. It's your fault that God isn't buying this commercial, you know. It's your fault. You didn't make the woman beautiful enough. She feels insecure somehow. No, she feels insecure because it's not working. God's not buying it. That's why she feels insecure. All this idea that women feel so insecure is because of men is nonsense. They feel insecure because the marketing they're doing isn't working. The commercial they're doing is not selling God on this product. What is the product? The body. The body. They're failing. And they keep thinking, if men just gave me a more beautiful dress or something, if it just let me feel more empowered, I would be able to sell God on this. No, that is not true at all. Their insecurity and their lack of empowerment comes because they can't sell God on this. It doesn't have anything to do ultimately with men at all. You know, it doesn't matter what men do or don't do. It's still not going to be able to sell God on it. So, you know, this whole blame game of demonizing men has got to stop. Everyone has to draw back from that. This isn't the issue at all. It's complete misdirection, total misdirection. And of course, you know, it's flip-flop because men used to demonize women saying you weren't doing enough to sell God on it, you know, right? You got to do more to sell God. Come on, it's not working. Do more, do more, do more. And it's women's fault. Now it's all men's fault that it's not working. So we get, you know, so if we just keep ping-ponging this, we're just going to continue on with this ridiculous charade of a hoax. You know, way down the line will be women's fault again, you know, and then down the line will be men's fault again. Constantly missing that it's nobody's fault except Spirit having this capricious idea. It's Spirit's fault, really. Spirit has to take responsibility for this instead of trying to project it onto bodies, you know, and say, well, no, it's the man's fault or it's the woman's fault. No, it's Spirit's fault. And ultimately, it's the continuity fear's fault. So we have to solve that continuity fear problem. If we don't solve that problem, we'll continue to blame one another. And, you know, the relationships are never what we want them to be, right? Never. We don't need any relationships body to body, actually. No, we need to have experience the one relationship that all Spirit has with the allness that is God. That's what we need to experience. So, you know, we need to all back away from this whole collective effort together. The idea that somehow if we make this effort more collective, it'll be successful is lunacy. This is the United Nations saying, it's got to be collective. Every single person has to now work on this, you know. And together we can succeed. No. Together we will just keep doubling down on futility. The more we collectively push this agenda, the more we are pushing, you know, the suffering of futility upon ourselves and the blame game upon ourselves. You know, it's a lose, 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 lose in every way possible. So what happened originally with feminism, originally they said, hey, men, stop blaming us for the failure. We're not to blame. Okay, I said, great. That's right, because it's impossible. So who's to blame? But what happened was they didn't do spiritual practice along with this backing away. So they said, well, marketing, you know, the marketing we were doing didn't work. Instead of saying, okay, nothing works, they said, hey. And what happened was then it tipped over into, you know, the radical feminism of, you know, we can do this. Yes, we can do this. We can market to God's destiny. If men just do what we tell them to do, we're going to be able to succeed at this. So this is what happened in the world, you know. So now I see the backing away was not an authentic, you know, it did not have the right follow through on it by right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice has to be there, or otherwise it'll just go back to immodesty, you know, from modesty to immodesty, you know, it'll just keep going back and forth. Blame game will go back and forth. The men will say, hey, you were too immodest, that's why it didn't work, and then, oh, okay, yeah, we're so terrible, we're wrong, we're to blame, and then it'll flip-flop back that way, and it'll just keep going on and on and on like this, and then at some point they'll say, hey, it didn't work, you men are the problem, the modesty you insisted on, that's the mistake we made, and we need to become more immodest now, and aggressive, and, you know, and tigerish, you know, this is what we need to be. And you're the reason why we failed, and it'll flip-flop that way. And it just keeps going on and on and on this way. It has been throughout history and will continue on and the United Nations Agenda 21 is just pouring gasoline on the fire to an extreme extent. So, we're just connecting the dots. I don't know what the answer is, but connecting the dots sure doesn't hurt at all. And, you know, it's bound to be helpful in some way here as we become aware of this dynamic. Wow. This is very, very deep insight into the entire social structure, you know, that we are dealing with and the spiritual dilemma that we're dealing with, which is ultimately a continuity of fear problem. So if you don't do spiritual practice to evaporate the continuity of fear, we're just going to keep ping-ponging. Guaranteed. Guaranteed, guaranteed, guaranteed. So ultimately, you know, modesty, backing away collectively, both back away from trying to sell God on anything. It becomes something it's not like we're not posing as modest. Women are not posing as modest, nor are they posing as immodest. They become more bland and neutral. It's kind of just feeling like this neutral feeling. It's just not, they're not interesting anymore. It's not important. It's not interesting. The body really isn't interesting. It's a different vibe. It's a different vibe. You know, there's some women like that. You're around them and it's just like, you know, there's no look at me-ness or anything. Look at this body. Well, look how modest I am, or look how immodest I am. It's just not there. Not there so much. Of course, they do keep up appearances, as if to say, well, hey, look how neutral I am. So, you know, they have a ways to go, right? Yeah, absolutely, and we all do. Because the men are still paying attention. I wonder how she's doing, you know, marketing to God. You know, the men should just pay no attention to women, basically. Just don't pay attention. Pay attention to the Holy Spirit. The men just become very disinterested and just, I don't really care how you look. You know, it doesn't, whether it's modest or immodest or neutral, you know, it doesn't matter. Body doesn't matter. We're not trying to hoax God here. We're just trying to evaporate the continuity fear. You know, so... Yeah, because you get these ingenues who come and say, look how pure I am, look how chaste I am, look how virginal I am, look how, you know, they're just like saying, look, screaming, look at me, look at me, look at me, look at me, pay attention to me. That's not it at all. That's not it at all. So there's just kind of this new bland neutrality, but that comes from spiritual practice. That's the only way it really, genuineness comes from spiritual practice. Someone's genuinely says, I'm not, marketing to God doesn't work, it's a hoax. This is all a hoax. And we have to evaporate our continuity fear. Doing the spiritual practice is what gives that genuine vibe. This is what everyone has to do, ultimately. And we have this global accord now to not do that. We have this massive will on the planet to not do this. So we live in terrible times right now, actually. And also the whole thing, look how smart I am. That's also trying to sell the body to God. You know, this whole thing, the person, the personality, is a hoax. Instead of that, just do neither nor. I'm neither smart nor am I not smart. I keep doing this neutrality exercise. This is what really works. I'm neither glamorous nor am I not glamorous. I'm neither bland nor am I not bland. I'm neither neutral nor am I not neutral. I'm neither this nor that. Keep doing the neutrality, 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 neutrality. You will find that this develops this insight and clarity that cannot be gotten in any other way. Thanks, all thanks to the Holy Spirit, the real teacher, the teacher, the real, real teacher, teacher of teachers, the teacher of teachers, the Holy Spirit. Our attention should be on the Holy Spirit. And asking the Holy Spirit, which is formless, completely formless. It's our true spirit. It's the voice of our true spirit as it truly is. The Holy Spirit is the voice of our spirit as it is, leading us back to acceptance of what is. So all thanks to the Holy Spirit for these videos, for the clarity. It's not my clarity. It's the Holy Spirit's clarity. Ultimately, that is my clarity. It's your clarity. It's all our clarity because we are spirit. But from a pragmatic standpoint, from right now, we'll say temporarily, we can say, you know, this comes from the Holy Spirit. I'm astonished at this clarity. You know, it's just like, wow. Where is this coming from? Well, it's coming from Spirit, Holy Spirit, which is the advocate, the voice of Spirit, as it is. So that's the real teacher. That's the real guru. That's the real savior, is the Holy Spirit. When we start pitting it on bodies, then you know we're right back in this hoax thing, really, to a certain extent, right? To a certain extent. We're happy for those who have this neutrality and have abiding in this. They encourage us and they show us what the Holy Spirit can do for us. But the real teacher is the Holy Spirit, okay? Let's not put any other teachers ahead of the Holy Spirit. Are even on the same level as the Holy Spirit. Okay, because we associate them with bodies to some extent. And this, to some extent, you know, does interfere in some way. We sort of associate, well, maybe God thought this is how to sell the body. Like Jesus sold God on the body. This is what many believe. That Jesus said, look, God, this is the body that you really made, right? Look how perfect this body is. And then God, we think that God said, oh yeah, Jesus, you're right. This is what I created. I didn't really create spirit, formless spirit. I created you, Jesus, the body. Many, many have believed this. This is not true at all. Okay, so it's a lot safer to make the Holy Spirit your real guru, your real teacher, your real savior. And the Holy Spirit's formless, you know, it's formless. So there's no way to glamorize the Holy Spirit. You're not. And it seems very dry and difficult, right? Because there's no glamorization in it, you know. I just say, Holy Spirit, help me, help me, help me. And the way that it helps me is so funny because it's so all-inclusive of everything in terms of just no specialness or glamour on anything. It just uses whatever will get my attention, you know, in the right way. It's just amazing how the Holy Spirit works. It will always give you a chuckle and shake your head and just say, oh, are you kidding me? How did you know that this was going to be here, right now, and put me right in this place that I saw just this, exactly at this moment, and it's exactly what I needed to see? How in the world did you orchestrate this? It's just, you know, I cannot believe how you could orchestrate this. It's extraordinary. Yeah, you just can't help but laugh, really. And the Holy Spirit's use of symbol, the way it uses symbols and stuff, and it gets you to, like, you might see a license, a vanity plate, and you read it, and the Holy Spirit says, read that plate, you know. You read it, and it says, da da da, and you say, oh my gosh, that's exactly what I needed to hear. That answers the question, a concern that I had. How the heck did you know that this car, this vanity plate, and it was going to be right here, and I needed to read that, and, you know, and then I would extrapolate it in the right way, you know, and it is, oh my gosh, this is too much. Really? Are you kidding me? This is really something, the power that Spirit has. We can't help but be kind of laugh along with it, you know. The Spirit, you know, is kind of laughing too, like, isn't this fun, you know? I mean, isn't it great that we have this perfect awareness? And we do. The Holy Spirit has perfect awareness of all, you know, of the isness of all, everything. It's just, I can't explain it, but you can experience it for yourself every day. And you just have to trust in the Holy Spirit that is guiding your life, even though it seems to do it in such unconventional, unorthodox way. You say, Holy Spirit, I wanted to do this. I went to the golf course to play, you know, to play, and now it's all jammed up and slow, and I'm all upset. And then you think, wait a minute. Maybe I came here to just practice on my swing changes and do this and this, and this gives me an opportunity to hit four balls off of every tee and chip, 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 and putt, and just practice, a practice round. That's exactly what I needed to do, actually, and the slow play enabled me to do this. So you say, thank you, Holy Spirit, you know. So you turn this glass half empty to glass half full. That's why I say always try to approach the day as glass half full. What that does is put your faith in the Holy Spirit, that it is going to deliver for you, you know, major progress today. But how it does it, you don't know. You're not going to know ahead of time. It's so artful that you can't even describe the artfulness of it. You know, it just somehow is orchestrating everything. Just okay, just accept it. Don't try to figure it out. Just accept it. Make the most of it. Don't try to figure it out. Make the most of it. Don't try to think, well, I need to be able to do this too. No, we don't need to ever function like the Holy Spirit, actually. Holy Spirit's a special blessing upon Spirit that enables Spirit to function in this way in relation to this hoax that we're trying to perpetrate. But once we're done with the hoax, we don't need to function in this way. So we don't have to try to figure out how the Holy Spirit does all this. In fact, the attempt to do so is a great mistake on our part. Just thank the Holy Spirit. You know, thank you so much, Holy Spirit, for everything you do in every way. And there's no way I can thank you enough because I don't even know what you're doing. I probably miss about 99% of it, you know. But I thank you for the 1% that I see, you know, because maybe that's enough. If we look back and saw everything that we missed, we would just be dumbfounded, you know. Maybe we see it, we say, well, I neither see it nor do I not see it, you know. Otherwise, we might be overwhelmed by it. But the Holy Spirit's always with everyone. It's always with everyone. Nanamayama was a non-glamorous woman. It was a woman who was not trying to sell God on anything. Okay, that is true. Perfect. However, the women the feminine who are trying, and the men who are trying to sell God on this hoax, you know, took her as this is the body that God is sold on. Like this, it seems like maybe God must have been sold on her, this body. So if we just be like her, if we can market this, and in the 60s, actually, she was marketed. It was amazing how clever women are, that somehow they picked up on her through pictures or something. They said, look at this holy woman. God loves this woman. She loves the way God must love the way she looks, her hair, the way she does. And so they all started wearing their hair and, you know, dyed it black, long black, you know, hair. And they tried to get into the style, trying to look like her, thinking, if this is how I can sell God on the God-created bodies. So even though you have someone in the world who is a perfect example, that doesn't stop us from trying to turn it into marketing the hoax on God. We just will say, this is the body that convinced God that God created bodies. Same with Jesus, same thing. We said, this is the body that God created, that convinced God that God created bodies. This is it. Right? This is what sold God on it. Same mistake. The world made it with Jesus, the world made it with Nanamayama. Same mistake. And so, you know, all the people, the comments on Nanamayama is amazing. I tried to get people to see what was really going on. They don't see it. They say, look how beautiful she is. Oh my gosh, this must be the body that, you know, this is God incarnate, you know, in the body. It's like they thought Jesus was God incarnate in the body. This body was so perfect, God said, I must be incarnate in this body, you know. I must have created this body. And they did the same thing with Nanamayama. They're still doing it. Look at this beautiful goddess. She's so beautiful. She looks so wonderful. She's so divine. They're talking about, you know, her body. They're not really getting, you know, the fact that she never even identified with her body, never gave a thought to the body. It's not, you know, why, you know, the purpose of it. But no, they say, this is how we can market it, you know. If we just like this. Of course, that didn't work. So they kind of said, okay. You know, not many people kind of, you know, said, let's move on and let's try something else. But there was a while there where women really tried to look like her. Even in the West, I don't know how they found out, but they did. They're psychic. Very psychic, actually, in terms of picking up, you know, what body image do I need to market? What body image I need to market? They're always aware somehow. How do I market the body image to God? And so it never ends. It's a, you know, it's just like a constant kaleidoscope of shifting body images that takes place here. The packaging, constant. You go into a market now, and it's, you realize that everything is being repackaged continuously. Continuously being repackaged. It's so extraordinary. Isn't it? And the repackaging is happening more and more and more and more frequently. I talk to the grocery people, they say, yeah. You know, it's just they're all, you know, just same product, but look at the different packaging, the ways that they package stuff now is just mind blowing. Chocolate bars, you know, the wrapping, you name it, right? Anything, just basically almost anything in a store now has got sleek new packaging in it. And go back in a couple months, it'll have different packaging, different fonts, different lettering, different styles, different colors, different shapes, different ways of making it appear, you know, more sexy, more glamorous, more attractive, more sleek, more, you know, this is what's going on everywhere. Go into any store, look at the products and how they're being packaged, repackaged, 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 repackaged. Why? I don't need that. You know, I say like this, just give me a car that works. I don't care if the car is 40 years old. You know, just, you know, let's let it get. Let me have a sweet ride. Let me get to where I want to go, and that's it. But oh no! We've got to repackage cars. I mean, a lot of people get new cars every two years. They trade in, or 3 years. They lease, you know, and then just trade in for another lease, trade in for another lease, trade in for another lease. Got to keep repackaging everything. Their clothing constantly changing, constantly updating their styles. Constantly updating their gadgets. You know, I got this flip phone. I feel so out of style. It's like I'm wearing bell bottoms. Like I'm wearing, you know, hippie beads and bell bottoms or something. You know, I mean, it's just like people think that you're like caveman. It's like, what are you doing? You're blowing our, you know, we're blow. You're blowing our hoax. We got to sell God that we're awesome. That human beings are awesome. You made an awesome creation, God. And when you made human beings, totally awesome creation. Look how awesome we are. So much awesomeness. And except that guy over there, he's like, what's the matter with that guy? You know, he's got some old flip phone. What the heck is going on? That's blowing our image. You're blowing our image, man. You're blowing our awesome image. What's with that, you know? What's with that? You're just not. You're hurting us, man. You're the United Nations. No one left behind. We want everybody to help one another. Make sure no one's left behind. Now, that's what they're saying. Make sure no one's blowing our image. You know, that's what they're saying. Make sure nobody blows our image. That we're just completely awesome. The human race is just so totally awesome. You must have created it, God. This must be your creation. This must be what you created. And you must be flesh too, God, therefore, right? You must also be flesh, God. And therefore, you must be not eternal life. You must be subject to death too, God. How about that? Nice little hoax flipping the script. So I found a few, like, and I'm marketing out of my mind because every time I try, all the people say is, oh my gosh, what a, you know, ravishingly beautiful goddess she is. Oh, I look at her, I think she's so beautiful. And you know that they're taking it on the level, you know, of the body. And making this association that this is what God, you know, was pleased by, that God says, here's a body that is worthy of, you know, that I can say this is my creation, you know, this is what I want you to look like as far as a body goes, you know. This is just, you know, completely missing it, totally missing this. Yeah, it's just ridiculous. It's spiritual practice, which is what she said. Practice, practice. She says, if you don't practice, everything is futile. You know, it doesn't matter if I come here. She says, if I come here, you know, I'm not going to be effective if you don't do spiritual practice at all. This is what's really important, is the practice you do. So every day you should be practicing briskly, more and more intensely. And she says, every day of your life should be spiritual sadhana, spiritual practice. And she says, this is actually the only responsibility that God has for you here in this world. And if you don't do that, you're just wasting your life completely. Which is true. Absolutely true. Because you're just spending time on this hoax. That's all you're doing. All we'll be doing. So, It's just hammered, constantly hammering, practice. But, you know, who's actually doing that now? You know, this modern age, the digital modern age, artificial age of artificial intelligence has turned everybody's head. No question about it. And the women are very confident in their packaging now. The lack of confidence they had back in the 50s and 60s. There was a time where in the 70s, the early 70s, where the women said, "You know what? You know, I don't think, you know, I'm not so confident that I can sell God on this hoax, to tell you the truth." And they actually would tell men that, you know, in so many words, like, I don't think I can get it done. I really don't. I don't think women can get it done. I think we've been wasting our time." And men said, "Wow, yeah, maybe this is true." Well, that time has come and gone entirely. Now they're very, very confident that they think they can sell God on this hoax. So don't let no one dares question their confidence. In other words, the Empress certainly is ravishingly beautiful. It's not like she's some dumpy Empress with no clothes on, like, "Oh my God, yeah." No, she's, you know, just look at her confidence. Yeah, she must be able to sell God on. She must have something that can sell God, that God created bodies. This is the attitude that is being pushed right now in everybody. So for me, I said, let me just go play golf. Let me just get out of this situation. And of course, they just use men now as practice, sparring partners. You know, like, hey guy, you know, I think I'm going to be able to sell God on this, but I want to work on you first. So why can you pretend to be real spiritual for me and not into the body, and then I'm going to work on you and seduce you so that I this helps me practice so I can get better and better, and let me find some flaws in my approach, so ultimately I can make my approach flawless so I can seduce God into believing that God created these bodies, this body, you know, bodies. So they're basically just using men now as a, you know, for target practice. This is what's actually going on. And the more spiritual you are, you know, the more tendency they think, hey, you know, if I can convince them, you know, that sell them on what I'm marketing, I can probably sell God. I might be able to sell God. And so let me see, you know, resistance. How can I break down the resistance? So, and practice breaking down your resistance, so then I can better break down God's resistance and sell them on this hoax. So men are just being used as target practice, sparring partners, and you know, who wants to spend their time doing that? And you know, it's all completely futile. Tell us, let's go play golf, you know, just get out of the situation, really. It's not benefiting anybody. So this is, you know, I don't know what will happen, but it may be just, you know, it's time for those who are, you know, still identifying as men, still identifying as women, to back away from this whole thing, you know, as much as possible. Who wants to be just used as target practice? Clay pigeons, you know, let me see if I can hit this one. Let me see if I can seduce this one. Let's see if I can break down the resistance of this one. Let's see if I can get them to abandon their, you know, their resolve. Yeah, let's see if I can get them to abandon that resolve towards realizing they're not the body. Let's see if I can turn them back into believing that we are the body. By presenting my body and my house and everything, my life is so attractive to them that they say, "Oh my gosh, yeah, I think God must have made bodies. Look how attractive you are." Yeah, this is just being used. Let's see if I want someone who has resolve, and so I can see if I can break down their resolve. Well, if someone has resolve, they work extremely hard at this resolve, just unbelievably difficult. Why should they then lend themselves to just this target practice? This is ridiculous. They should use their resolve to continue to strengthen it even more so, and stay away from temptation. Is the Lord's Prayer, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Absolutely. So I don't want to, you know, just hang around a situation where I'm just being viewed as you know, as a someone to be used in terms of seeing how well my resolve can be broken down. That's like the worst use of time possible from my standpoint. Terrible. Lose-lose situation. So really there's a need to protect those who have the resolve, you know, male and female, protect them from this hideous, seductive society we have right now that views everyone with any resolve as an opportunity to try out, you know, try out busting their resolve. Oh, here's someone, they must be here simply to help me practice busting their resolve down. That's why they're here. That's what they really want to do. They want to try and help me become greater at busting down God's resolve. That's what the purpose must be. You know, there's a complete misread on their part of the purpose of those who have resolve. Total misread. And, you know, this is, you know, something has to be done about this. I just try to, you know, just stay out of the picture as much as possible. But, you know, how do you function in society, you know, in doing that? It's become extraordinarily difficult. You know, if you say you're a spiritual person, they, ah, really? Great. Okay. Now, you know, and then they say, you know, it's like, okay, now how do I, you know, let me see if I can sell and get them interested in the body again. Like, oh, God gave me this opportunity, see, to work on this. As if God wants to be sold. You know, they believe God wants to be sold on believing God created bodies. So God sent me this person with a lot of resistance so I can work on breaking down the resistance. That's God, God's, oh, it's a God, God sent here. You know, no. That's a total misread of the situation. Totally egoic misread of the situation. Continuity fear misread of it. So the misreading of that situation is pandemic. Totally pandemic. It's like a severe pandemic plague right now in the world. Spiritual pandemic plague. The princess pandemic plague, you might say. The princess pandemic plague, princess just assumes, oh yeah, I mean, God's just given me this, all these opportunities to practice breaking down resolve so I can finally break down God's resolve and help God realize that reality was really just a fantasy and a dream, and creating bodies is actually the reality. And they believe that God, this is what God wants. And God's just saying to them, well, please help me. You need to sell me on bodies. For some reason, I keep thinking of this crazy dream that you're really formless, you know, formless spirit that's perfectly free. But I, you know, and so they think, the princesses think they're helping God, you know, become sane and get rid of this fantasy of perfect, formless perfection. So they think that God is just, you know, just sending them these, you know, pigeons for target practice, clay pigeons for target practice. Meanwhile, we're saying, whoa, no. That's not what we're here for at all. Just the opposite. So this is not being recognized somehow. It's crazy it's not being recognized. Insane. And it gets me quite upset. I you know, I shake up the teacher, say, what are you doing? You know, just ask the Holy Spirit. I don't know what the teachers are doing, but the Holy Spirit's the real teacher. So, Holy Spirit, do something about this. This is just, you know, but the Holy Spirit won't do something about it until we connect the dots and realize this is our problem. This is our problem. The only value anyone sees in those who have resolved to turn away from the body is a value to use them as patsies to see if they, you know, how well they can be seduced back into believing in the body. You see, that's the only value they see in them, which is no value at all. So really being seen as valueless here. This is terrible. This is a terrible pandemic. Princess pandemic plague, you know, you name it, you know, it's just horrible. So, but now seeing it, okay, we can say, hey, Holy Spirit, you know, okay, next step is dealing with this effectively here. So it puts us in a great position. This is where I've been at today. I've seen this, and I say, hey, Holy Spirit, you know, hey, this is bad. This is bad news going forward here. Our resolve is going to be seen as something that they think that God just presented in order for them to work on taking us down. And that if we object to this, that we're doing against God's will and we're being criminal. So we have no right to object to it whatsoever. This is how they're going to see it. I saw this very clearly. I said, holy cow, you got to do something here, Holy Spirit. This is really bad news. So, we'll see what the Holy Spirit does, right? We'll see what the Holy Spirit does here. Now that we have this great clarity. So, all right. I keep doing follow-ups. I keep following up. I'm giving extraordinary information out here. The Holy Spirit's giving extraordinary information, but I'm willing to, present it and share it out here. But there needs to be follow-up, because this is really heavy-duty stuff we're talking about here. And thank God that some are listening and some are getting it, It's reverberating. They're saying, wow. Wow, this is true. I see this. Holy cow. But what do we do about it? Okay, well, we'll follow up on this. We'll keep following up. See what kind of protection, we can get for this. Without us trying to figure out what it may be, let us just keep practicing, neither nor. I neither see it, nor do I not see it. Keep practicing, and we will see how the Holy Spirit, goes from this standpoint that we have. It's a very advanced standpoint now. Almost unprecedented. It's precedent. There's precedent that we just aren't aware of because it's been buried. But there have been, other times and places where there have been awareness of this whole dynamic. Of course, really wise spiritual teachers, etc., are aware of this dynamic for sure. They have to be. But right now, it's as bad or as worse as it has ever been, and maybe the worst that it's ever been right now. And the danger to our resolve is probably the worst that it's ever been. Exponentially, to a factor of who knows how bad, we could be in real severe danger of losing our resolve and having it just seen the only value we have to society is to use ourselves as punching bags, really. I don't want to be a punching bag. I don't want to be anybody's punching bag. And I feel the society, the only value they will give to me going forward is just be as a punching bag to see how can we punch this guy and, until he loses resolve, And women are becoming very aggressive in their punchiness, super aggressive. That's why they're taking all these martial arts classes and ultimate fighter class. They're doing all this super aggressive punchy stuff. So because they're going to become very, very punchy, believe me. Shocking. I see these women in boxing. They're as vicious as men. They're into all this very severe Amazonian punchy stuff. And they're becoming very punchy in society. Look at the way they're driving. I guess a lot of the very maniac drivers are women now. Super aggressive. Very punchy. And their attitudes are very punchy too. They even feel like, man, I feel like just punching you. I'm going to punch you. I'm going to punch your resolve. I sense some resolve in you. Well, guess what? My right is to use you as a punching bag. This is the attitude of a lot of these princesses right now, isn't it? So I'm not speaking just to men. I'm speaking to women and men. Back away from this very bad scenario. Get protection for the resolve that you have to not see yourself as a body, not try to market the body to God as this hoax. So back away, get protection for your resolve. Protect your, you deserve, your, whatever it is the resolve you have, you deserve to have that protected. And somebody has to have our back here on this, because we do not want to be punching bags for these very punchy princesses. The punchy princess plague. The punchy princess pandemic is what we're really in right now. Severely, the punchy princess pandemic. PPP. The triple P, the Punchy Princess Pandemic. And this is, it may sound funny, but everyone knows this is true. There's not a joke. It's not a joke at all. I'm shocked at what I'm experiencing right now. How dare anybody look at me in such a light? Oh, here's somebody to use as a punching bag. After all the work I've put in to clarify all this, you know, it's just they see, oh, maybe I should, I think I kind of want to feel like using this guy as a punching bag. So, hey, mister, sit there, Mr. Punching Bag. You know, that's all you are, you know, so is your punching bag. And anything else, that is illegal. You're a criminal if you don't lie, if you don't accept that you're just a punching bag. So, I'm sounding the alarm here. The Punchy Princess Play Pandemic. This is what's happening in the world. This is an extraordinary pandemic that we need to be protected from. Severe measures need to be taken place to protect the spiritual resolve on this. The resolve that we've built up that must be protected. Otherwise, we're going to end up just as punching bags. We're going to have the stuffing knocked out of us. Holy Spirit's aware of this. It shows me all this stuff. It says, look at this, look at this, look at this. Now, we don't want to get into punching contests because the laws have all been rigged now to enable the Punchy Princess pandemic. So if you try to punch back, you know, you're going to be putting chains, and then really everybody will use you as a punching bag. You'll be, you know, you'll have the stuffing knocked out of you. Be nothing left. So what we're asking for is not punching back, but protection. So that the Holy Spirit has our back and, you know, somehow insulates us from this Punchy Princess pandemic. Worst pandemic in history right now. Is raging in the world. Worst pandemic in history. Nothing else even comes close. The Antonine plague, what, Augustinian plague, the first Black Death, the second, last, you know, Vienna plague, first, you know, the Spanish influenza, you name whatever plagues throughout history that have taken place. Nothing comes remotely close to the Punchy Princess plague. And most people, they're aware of it, but they feel like a deer in headlights. You know, this is what I'm seeing. I see that many people are aware of this, but again, deer in headlights, they don't know what to do about it. They just say, wow, I hope I don't get punched too much, too badly. Well, that's like saying, oh, gee, I hope I don't catch the bubonic plague, you know, when you're living in a rat-infested environment. You know, I mean, of course everybody hoped they wouldn't catch it. But they needed to get the heck out of Dodge, you know, get away from the fleas. Are you kidding, you know? I hope I don't catch the smallpox epidemic. Which, you know, terrible plagues in the New World, what we call the New World, but the indigenous people here, they never had smallpox. Smallpox was brought over, along with a bunch of other stuff, and kaboom, you know, they all died. 90% of the population, I mean, decimated. Smallpox decimated them. You know, but this Punchy Princess plague is a complete global pandemic, decimating this planet right now. And the worst is yet to come. The worst is yet to come. It's going to get way, 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 way worse. So, we need some Punchy Princess pandemic plague breakers right now, you know? We need some inoculation. Some shelter. Some insulation. Some firewall, you know, some spiritual firewall. So, we'll just let this marinate and settle in and go from there. Very effective video. I feel that we're pushing things forward here in October, you know, to a great extent, and we're having great success. it's the month to just go for it and get it all the success we can possibly muster here. And we're doing exactly that. And okay, it's after midnight. I do have to get up early tomorrow. So that's good enough for now. Full stop in the wow. Just let it marinate. Do all your practicing. Keep, just do spiritual practicing, neither nor, whatever your spiritual practice is that you like. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I can, I will, I've already done it. I can see this, I will see this, I've already seen it. You can do the practice, or I'm neither seeing it nor am I not seeing it. I'm neither seeing it nor am I not seeing it. You know, some form of practice like along these lines that is effective for you. Just keep doing that, doing it, doing it, doing it, doing it, doing it, doing it. Keep applying it to every type of situation that arises for you. And you will be able to keep pace with what's taking place here, okay? This is the way to do it. Okay, very great. This has been an awesome video to participate in. And I look forward to seeing, you know, what the Holy Spirit has for us after having done this video. Very great, that's it.